The senses of a white-tailed deer are uncanny. Its ears are like radar, its eyes almost like a hawk's, but its nose. That's what separates a white-tailed deer from so many other critters, and I think the deer's nose is what contributes to the big rack like this one has, because that nose detects danger, allows it to live longer and grow those big antlers. The sense of smell, it's really a wonder, but I have some videotape that's going to help unlock this world for bow hunters especially, so stay tuned. I'm Fred Trost. We're going to talk about the deer's sense of smell. It's Thursday night. Time for Michigan Outdoors.
From the rugged shore and woodlands of the north, its history of copper mines and iron ore, the Great Lakes fisheries. To the farmlands of the southern counties, we'll look around again at all that waits the sportsman in the state of Michigan. And sometimes when the moon brings out the diamonds in the snow and the stillness of the forest lies encased in Arctic cold, the wind might whisper through the trees, listen if you can, it tells you of the beauty in this state of Michigan.
You're looking at one of the most historic moments from our Michigan Outdoors tape library, the evening of opening day of bow season, 1984, Lost Arrow Lodge in Gladwin. I'm in a tree stand in the upper left, and I take a shot at the spikehorn buck at the lower right. Well, I missed right there, no doubt about that. The doubt is, why? We'll take another look at the sequence, this time in slow motion. Now watch the deer. Interesting, huh? Well, it apparently ducked the arrow. Now we'll slow it down a little bit more, and if your TV set is good quality, you'll be able to see the arrow. It's a small streak of white over the buck's back. Can you see it right there? Now look at that deer squat. Now there's the arrow. Many bow hunters said the deer saw my arrow coming and ducked, but I disagree. That deer never saw anything. My proof? Well, here we are at dawn, earlier that day, the same setup. A smaller buck came past my stand just after sunrise. This was a button buck. Too small. I had no interest in taking a shot, so I just watched. It ambled on in, feeding, walking, looking, and listening, and I was watching from the tree. My feet were crossed, bow on my lap, not making a sound or moving at all. This little buck was using all its senses. Its eyes to watch for unusual movements, something that might be a threat. Those big ears, 24 square inches of reflective surface per ear, compared with 3.5 inches per ear for humans. The deer's ears swivel like radar. And in a moment, a noise in a nearby tree is going to spook this little buck. I want you to watch how he moves. Remember how that spike buck moved when he heard my bowstring? Watch this. Oh, that was fast, but let's go back. Remember, there was no arrow, just a noise. And watch the buck as he squats down half his normal height. Now that's what he has to do in order to get a good spring to jump away. There he is standing up at full height. The noise? He drops down, rolls his shoulders, and pushes off. The exact same motion the other deer used when I shot the arrow. That it gave the illusion that the deer ducked the arrow. In reality, he was just reacting to the sound. That's how deer always react when they're startled. Now he's alert, gathers his wits, his ears picking up any other clues. He stomps his foot. That sends out a vibration in the ground that other deer can feel through their sensitive hooves. There's another stomp right there. He walks forward. He doesn't see, hear, or smell any danger. Now, the signal that this is a false alarm is its tail. There, a little flip of the tail. The all-clear signal that nothing's been discovered, so it's back to eating. But don't be fooled. That little buck is still swiveling its ears, watching all around, and especially working its nose to smell danger. Now for a study in smell, let's go to the Houghton Lake Deer Research Station. Here's a big buck with a group of does. In situations like this, the bucks act independently. Now, saying that they're leading the does and fawns is giving them much too much credit. Actually, they don't care at all about the other deer. He's concerned about us, our cameras. We're about 75 yards away using a telephoto lens. The wind is swirling around, blowing hard, making it difficult for the deer to get a good scent. And it's only through scent that a deer can positively identify danger. Danger to them is the smell of an animal that eats meat, one that gives off those meat-eating amino acid odors. That's the danger signal to deer. Whether it's the smell of a dog or a mountain lion, a wolf, bear, or a human, it makes no difference to a deer. We all eat meat, and we all eat deer. We have the opportunity to sniff the wind better. The deer often does this. Now watch. See that? Now, I'm not talking about moving its ear. Watch its tongue. There it goes. It licked its nose. Deer do that when they're trying hard to get a better whiff. Understanding how deer use their sense of smell and what conditions they prefer can give you some good clues as to how to be a more successful hunter. Now, big bucks like this have unusually sharp senses, quick reflexes, solitary habits. And little bucks, like this one here in the shadows, will only grow up to be a big buck if it has those kind of abilities too. I'm taking these tapes from a tree stand back at Lost Arrow Lodge one evening last October, a day typical of the weather we've been having lately, windy, rainy, it's dark, the deer are beginning to stir, but when the conditions are like this, deer aren't that comfortable about moving. Take their ears, for example. With all the wind blowing through the leaves, they can't hear much. Or should I say, they hear everything with those big ears, nothing but noise, and that's disconcerting to a deer. With their big eyes, to look around, they can see nearly 360 degrees. They see nothing but motion. All the leaves, all the limbs, everything's moving. My tree stand right there is moving. I can't hold the camera steady. And how can they pick out danger? Well, it's tough. That's why they stand still. Their noses, well, that's what they need to pick out the danger. There's problems there, too. The odors have to be mixed or dissolved with moisture. About 50 to 70% humidity is ideal. The moist air molecules hits the most moist nose of a deer. The scent pops through. That's how deer read the wind. When it's raining or snowing like it is here, the scents are diluted, dissipated in the raindrops, and fall to the ground. Same way with fog or a light mist. The scent can't travel far. That makes the deer a little jumpy, so they don't move in conditions like this, except to thicker cover, to hold tight, waiting for the wind to die down and the rain to stop. And when that happens, we see all the same characteristics that we always see in the deer. Here he comes. Its tail says it's all clear, but before it steps into the clearing, it wants a better whiff. Did you see that? Let's back up. It licked its nose, put more moisture by its nostrils to trap a few more molecules from the air. Didn't detect danger, so it moves on. But wait a minute, it's not going to let its guard down. This buck has all the characteristics of a survivor. Sharp senses, nervous, solitary, constantly licking its nose to test the wind, guard for a meat eater of any kind. That's how those little nubbins on this buck might grow up to be a big rack someday in Michigan outdoors. And the leaves are dropping fast. Good news for hunters. We'll have some big bucks on our trophy book, but right now, let's take a look at some of the big fish that have been caught recently. Bob Stockton from Gladwin says he enjoys catching catfish. This one gave him a 15-minute battle. He lost another one the same day, he said was even bigger. He was bass fishing with a MEP spinner, Small Wood Lake in Gladwin County last year at this time. That 32-inch channel cat weighed 13 pounds, quite a trophy. Now, not too many people enter fish in this category. It's a panfish, common to many Michigan lakes, but 1 pound, 10 ounces makes it a trophy for Tom Mutchler from Warren, fishing Burt Lake in Sheboygan County with a night crawler and a jig. That rock bass stretched 13 inches. Probably not making the master angler wait, but making our fishing award length is this walleye, 29 inches long, caught by Ken Seisland from Westland. He was fishing with Captain Mark Martin a couple weeks ago in Muskegon Lake, trolling with a rebel. What time? 1 o'clock. A.M., of course. Young Jason Hesse from Bangor was probably after a Kalamazoo River early salmon or steelhead. At least he was using salmon eggs for bait. But he came up with a species of catfish that isn't reported all too often in Michigan. It's a flathead catfish. Look how wide that head is. 14 pounds, 4 ounces, 33 inches long. That must have made his heart thump to pull that baby in. And coming up to Michigan from Westerville, Ohio, was Glenn O'Neill, who fished off Manistee recently. His prize was this 19-pound Skamania steelhead, one of those tail-walking acrobats that everyone likes to catch. 37 inches long, the kind of trophy you always remember. He caught it on a wigglewort, by the way, 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Now, the perch have subsided off Harbor Beach, at least that's my latest reports, but when Dennis Chalmers reported they were hot, they were. That was earlier in September. 7-year-old Teresha DeRosset from Otisville proved it with this perch that took after a salmon lure. It hit a Northport nailer. 1 pound, 4 ounces, it went 15 inches. Her dad's a taxidermist, so I'm sure this trophy will go on the wall. Now, here's a fish from Lake George. Now hold it, not the Lake George around Clare. This Lake George is the one up around Sugar Island in the UP, Chippewa County. David Gould from Stockbridge was trolling a 4-inch Rapala with 8-pound test line going for northern pike in the old shipping canal. He had to put down his rod and help his wife net this one, which bent the net. Should, 36 and a half pounds, 50 inches long, a Great Lakes muskie caught exactly 1 year ago, which makes David Gould our Michigan Outdoors Trophy Angler of the Week.
Last Saturday, the special Senate committee held a public hearing at Okemos High School. They're looking at the laws and how they affect handicapped sportsmen. A number of sportsmen that do have varying degrees of handicaps were on hands with to give them some suggestions, like this suggestion from amputee Grant Church.
How do you do? My name is Grant Church. I'm a resident of Oakland County. I have, for some time, tried to promote legislation making it permissible for handicapped persons who cannot use the conventional bow and arrow to be given a special permit to use the crossbow. And I mention the special permit because I don't favor making it legal for anyone that wants to use it willy-nilly. I think it should be limited to those that cannot, that want to deer hunt in bow season and cannot use the conventional crossbow, that he may be given some kind of a special permit, just as we have for handicapped parking. We put the little tab on the corner of the car. We could carry one in our pocket or have a patch to pin on us to show that it's legal for us to use that. So I guess you'd call this a recommendation. I would strongly support it, and I hope that we have many others to do the same.
Grant Church is one of the many handicapped sportsmen who came to the Okemos public hearing with suggestions to make the outdoors more accessible. The recent Michigan floods have left the Shiawassee federal and state waterfowl areas in shambles. The corn strips you see in the middle of what appears to be a lake are now totally covered with water, leaving no hunting cover whatsoever. Due to this record flooding, the DNR and the Fish and Wildlife Service have changed the hunting schedules drastically. Many veterinarians across the state are concerned about the widespread use of a cattle warmer called ivermectin. This potent drug is being used in many cases privately as a way to prevent heartworm in dogs. There is little doubt that it works well at preventing canine heartworm, but the possible side effects can cause death in dogs. Vets I've talked to have used the drug effectively, but have reduced the dosage recommended for cattle to only a fraction of the recommendation. One vet in particular, Dr. Will Schultz of Okemos, wanted me to warn people that ivermectin has not been approved for use in dogs by the government, even though it might be within a year or two. It's also considered an off-label drug with no known antidote, leaving a pet owner with no recourse should side effects or death occur.
Bow hunting, Bob, we have a lot of it in the Outdoor Digest. We have, of course, this article by Tom Opry on scrape hunting.
That's a good article.
Another aspect of deer behavior that's kind of interesting. And a lot of people are interested in bow hunting, including youngsters, but they have questions because of the license law. And here's one from David Stearns from Greenville. He says, I'm 10. When I turn 12, do I have to take a gun safety class in order to shoot a bow and arrow? And can I go out opening day of gun deer season with my bow?
Question number one. The answer to it is, does he have to take the gun safety class? That is a hunter safety class. And yes, before he can buy a hunting license, he must take it. Also, the second question, when he's 12, can he go hunt opening day of the gun deer season with a bow license? No, you can't. In order to hunt during the firearm deer season, you must have a firearm deer license, and you can't buy one until you're 14.
But when he is 14, If he chooses to use a bow during the gun deer season, he can on his gun deer license.
Right, but he'll have to wear hunter orange, too. That's important to remember. Bow hunters can't use camouflage.
Or hunt from tree stands during the firearm deer season.
They can hunt from tree stands.
They can?
Yeah.
I tell you, this is complicated. Check your digest on every count. The confusion of these seasons is something else.
Yeah, I better check it out myself again. Bernard Balicki from Getzville writes in at Fred, and he says, is there any way the DNR would give us or sell us some pheasant chicks to raise and release in the eastern Upper Peninsula? We have some excellent habitat, and we've seen a couple in the area. We'd like to have the privilege of waking up in the morning and hearing a rooster crowing.
Who wouldn't? I mean, you know, it's almost to the point, buy a chicken if you wanted to do that.
It's not that great down here.
Yeah, serious answer to the question. The DNR does not give away or sell pheasant chicks. There are game breeders who do, 36 of them in the state, and you could buy one from them. Also, check the Cooperative Extension Service, your 4-H county agent, because they do have a program of that nature. Mm-hmm. Possibly could get pheasant chicks that way. They take off in the UP. Hey, we'll be up there opening day.
Oh, yeah, that'd be great.
Now a question about grouse right now on our outdoor quiz.
The breast meat on grouse is white, while ducks have dark breast meat. Now, why the difference? Well, grouse are walkers and make only short flights in the woods, leaving the flight muscles in their breasts relatively undeveloped. Migratory waterfowl that make extended flights have highly exercised flight muscles that contain large numbers of blood capillaries and amounts of oxygen, which contribute to making the dark meat dark.
I'm really excited. I really am. I may not look it, but I am so excited about Outdoors Forever, something I've talked about for the past 6 months. It is now a reality. It is a 501c3 corporation, tax exempt. It has an executive director, Roger McCarville. Congratulations. You were selected by the board last week, the brand new board, to be executive director. Things are really rolling on this. To bring some of you folks up to date on what Outdoors Forever is, it's an organization. The goal is to enable everyone to continue hunting, fishing, and shooting throughout their lives. Originally began as just a handicapper's organization for our wheelchair friends like yourself, Roger, but it's something everybody can benefit from.
Right. For disabled folks, no matter what your disability is, there's no reason to stay in, and I think the Outdoors Forever is going to develop programs and goals to get people out.
Start them when they're young and keep them in hunting and fishing all their lives. We have 10 goals in this organization, 10 objectives. Let's take a look at them. The first one
I think is the number one is an educational center, to have a place where we can go, we can design things, we can have programs, we can have workshops there, held there, that we can show people how to use the outdoors, how to use their disability to their advantage.
And two other goals we have objectives is to produce a magazine, which we're going to have a supplement to the Outdoor Digest beginning in the next issue on Outdoors Forever. We're also going to be producing radio and TV programming, which we're doing right now, using Michigan Outdoors every week for a couple minutes to explore this area of lifelong hunting and fishing opportunities.
We want to have workshops, lectures, places we can go out. There's things that we learn that we can go out and talk to people, show them on a hands-on basis how they can continue their lifelong ambition of hunting and fishing.
And our studies and surveys, some things that will involve you folks in through the magazine, the digest, through television right here, studies and surveys about fishing piers, for example, or your attitudes, problems, and difficulties, and hey, we can get these things solved with the input.
Right, we want to watch the legislation, laws that are being passed, are they good for us, bad for us? What input do handicapped people have on the laws?
As well as commissioning research on things that might emanate from the legislation that we'll be monitoring. Some things might need further scientific study. Then, one of my favorites, erecting piers and facilities. I hope that we can put a fishing pier on a lake such as Houghton Lake. It would be a beautiful place. Everybody could benefit, because pier fishing is a way to open up the outdoors for handicappers and everybody.
And it's a way to do it socially. You can go out together with your grandfather, might have a stroke, or yourself. We just yesterday went over through the screening commission of the DNR on piers, and we want to see how many are accessible.
We're going to be doing that, and two last points. We'll be able to make gifts and grants to other organizations to help further these goals, and we'll also solicit grants and contributions, which you'll mainly find out about in the magazine. We'll be talking about that in the future, but it's a great opportunity for a lot of you folks. If you're interested, be sure to write us so we get you on our Outdoors Forever mailing list. Raj, it's going to be super.
Well, thank you, and I enjoy looking forward to working with you and running the Outdoors Forever.
Bonnie Ziedler from Cass City, your venison Swiss recipe is about going to receive the taste test under which all recipes are judged on this program. Bob Garner,
Would you like some parsley, Bob?
Oh, yeah, well, sure. Then. Let's, okay,
we've got to leave that on the plate because it looks good. You can have it when we're done.
Okay, good.
Okay, this is called Venison Swiss.
Made with tender.
It is. It looks mighty good, and the sauce smells good. Of course, the venison, when you see venison,
there's no marbling, really.
No marbling in the meat at all, which is
not
why
like
you
beef. That's
have
right.
to cook it with a moist method of cookery.
And any fat there is, you definitely want to remove because that's where your strong taste is.
That's the off flavor that some people say is gamey. It's from the fat.
Basically
that
around the edges, and that's about all there is of it.
Well, I see we have onion soup.
Dry
in this
onion
recipe.
Soup, mushrooms, green peppers, some steak sauce, and that's what you can make a sauce out of. Tomato juice, cornstarch just for thickening, some butter.
Or margarine.
There is a little bit of butter in this, Bob. You did ask about that. Mm-hmm. That's just to grease the aluminum foil. You just want to oil that a little bit.
And then we take the venison. Boy, look at that. You know, that is nutritious. Oh. That's as nutritious a meat in low cholesterol.
Yep, you bet.
As
just
healthy
like
as
that.
You can find.
This is so easy. Just go sprinkle this on. Now, this has got quite a bit of bouillon in it. Your onion soup does, so that's why you don't add salt to it.
Quite salty from
the
start.
It is, just by itself. Now, there's not a lot of green peppers in this, but just the little bit there is, you can taste them.
You can smell it right now.
Yep. Mushrooms, you could use fresh mushrooms. We use canned here. Like I say, you're going to make a sauce, just like she says, it's a venison Swiss.
So there's 2 cups of
tomato juice.
Tomato juice, and then
a little bit of extra
steak sauce. What does that steak sauce have?
It's got molasses and flavorings in it. The dark, usually in your steak sauces, is molasses. And then cornstarch. Is real fine. Cornstarch is finer than flour. And that's why it mixes so well and thickens up real quick. You don't need a... Now, if you're using flour, you'd use quite a bit more. Just pour that right over the top. Then you're going to fold your foil over and actually bake it right in the foil. It's going to kind of steam in there all together. So it'll
and
won't
that's
take
it.
Too long. Yep.
Venison Swiss and Bob is all out.
All gone.
Here we go.
Good, Bob.
Another chunk
what
and there's a piece
the rest
of parsley.
Of that
the rest of it is for you when you get that done. Now, what is your analysis, Bob?
Absolutely delightful. The venison is very tender, but yet it's not falling apart. Okay, it hasn't been just cooked the bejabbers out of. It's great stuff, and the mushrooms and all the vegetables really come through. It's super. Good recipe.
You could cook it longer and have it fall apart.
Oh, sure you could.
Don't,
why?
No, don't do that.
Don't do that for Bob, but you can for yourself if you wish. Tell you, the recipe's right here in our digest. Bob will tell you how to get a hold of it in just a minute. Hope you can get outdoors this weekend. It's a great place to be. See you next week.
Here he comes. Its tail says it's all clear. But before it steps into the clearing, it wants a better whiff. Did you see that? Let's back up. It licked its nose, put more moisture by its nostrils to trap a few more molecules from the air. Didn't detect danger, so it moves on. But wait a minute, it's not going to let its guard down. This buck has all the characteristics of a survivor. Sharp senses, nervous, solitary, constantly licking its nose to test the wind, guard for a meat eater of any kind. That's how those little nubbins on this buck might grow up to be a big rack someday in Michigan outdoors.